Now, many people don't remember this now, but let's move back 7 years ago. When a warrant of arrest was issued against you, you were not in the Philippines.
No, I was in the Philippines.
Okay.
Two months before.
Yes. There was a period you were not in the Philippines.
Yes.
And you actually had the option.
Yes.
Not to face the justice system here, not to be detained.
Yes.
Let's go back to that so people understand.
Yes.
The risk that you actually took, the choice you made.
Yes, 2 months earlier, December of 2016, because I was arrested February of 2017. I was invited. I received an award in the United States, and then from there I went to Germany for a speaking engagement. So when I was there in the United States, some friends of mine called me and said that, you know, it's almost
certain.
A certainty that charges will be filed against you, that you will be imprisoned. So you better not come back anymore. You have the option to just stay there and then apply for asylum. And in fact, when I was in Germany, there were about two groups. I cannot mention who they are. They represent governments, and they said that they are willing to grant me political asylum. So I had that option not anymore to return to the country to face my charges. But it was a no-no to me. I cannot. I have to face the charges because, you know, in law, flight is indicative of guilt. People would think that I'm guilty of the charges. And secondly, I needed to clear my name. So I had to return, even if I knew that that time, two months earlier, that that's going to happen, the filing of charges and the arrest. Mm.
You know, that story alone makes people often wonder, would we do what Leila de Lima did? I mean, with a justice system in the Philippines, and I'm sorry to say this, I don't see a lot of people having the option for asylum, for protection abroad, to actually choose to be detained. Mm-hmm. That alone is something.
Well, first, I'm a lawyer, and I cannot lose faith in the justice system. I was trained to be a lawyer. Then I taught in law school. I taught students to respect the rule of law. Mm-hmm. I taught students to respect and have faith in the judiciary. Now, with all of its flaws, there is hope that the justice system would really work if only the right people are there, and if only it's left alone by those in power. Mm-mm. So I have to work within the system and with the knowledge and with the conviction that it is only through the justice system that I would be freed, that I would be vindicated. I cannot be vindicated if I'm just, you know, I'll be out there. Who would not? A foreign government cannot vindicate me. A foreign government cannot proclaim me as innocent. I have to be officially proclaimed as innocent by domestic authorities because it's the domestic authority that put me to task.
Pero saan nang galing ang tiwala mong ito sa ating justice system with former President Duterte in power? Look at former Senator Ping Lacson. You remember this particular case, right? A warrant was issued against him and he said he did not... he did not surrender himself because he didn't have faith then in the system under former President Gloria Arroyo. Yours was under Duterte.
Well, I cannot really second guess what else. What were the other thoughts that former Senator Ping Lacson had? Yes, he didn't have faith in the previous government before Pinoy government. I also didn't have faith in Duterte because he was my persecutor, but I have faith in the justice system. I know that no matter how it would take, that no matter how long it would take for the justice system to work in my case, it would ultimately work in my favor. My lawyers would see to it that the right moves will be taken, that we would go through the right proceedings before the court, we would be filing the right pleadings, and if need be, we would be presenting our defense evidence, just like what happened in the second case where I was acquitted, that went through that stage. Mm. Unlike the first case, it went only as far as the demurrer stage. Mm-hmm. We filed a demurrer, it was dismissed, which was mm-hmm. tantamount to acquittal. Mm-hmm. And then the second case, it was acquittal because our demurrer was, our motion for demurrer was denied, mm-hmm. and so we had to present our defense evidence. So it was full judgment of acquittal. We presented defense evidence. We were ready, and we did present defense evidence. And now this third case, the prosecution has rested its case. So we will soon be filing our comments and objections to the formal offer. The court has to rule on the formal offer. And again, just like the first and the second cases, we will file again mm-hmm. our demurrer to evidence. And if it's granted, again, it would be dismissed. So all the proceedings we went through, all the pleadings that needed to be filed were filed by my lawyers. All the arguments mm-hmm. were presented before the courts. So no matter, even if we anticipated that we would have a hard time, ultimately, it would work.
Mm. All right. Now, this is for the audience. Some of them may not have caught up with this. There were three drug cases filed against former Senator Leila de Lima. Two have been dismissed, just for layman's terms, to keep it simple. She's out on bail now for the third case. That third case, it may be dismissed, she may be acquitted, but that's the present situation. Now, you were Justice Secretary. Then, now, you were the respondent, right?
Yes.
You've been on the other side. Mm-hmm. Just enumerate to me the weaknesses you now experienced mm-hmm. in the justice system with you mm-hmm. wanting justice, wanting freedom. What did you live with?
Well, I have to be careful in my response to mm-hmm. that, because we may be treading through the rule, mm. the sub judice rule.
Uh-oh.
But although I've been saying this, that what was really questionable was the use of the PDL witnesses who were convicted mm. of crimes involving moral turpitude. Mm-hmm. We really found it questionable because it's violative of the law. So why use this witnesses when they know mm-mm. they knew then mm-mm. that it was against the law.
Mm-mm.
So the Justice Secretaries after Justice Aguirre, I expected them to order a thorough review of the cases, because those witnesses were under their control, and so that they would know what exactly prompted these witnesses to testify. And for mm-hmm. us, they falsely testified against me. So they should have dug deeper mm-hmm. into those cases, and they had the option to withdraw those mm-hmm. cases. Mm-hmm. That is what I was expecting mm-hmm. first from former Secretary, Justice Secretary Menardo Guevara after Aguirre, mm-hmm. and also the new secretary. So I was deeply disappointed when they did not do that, mm-hmm. because their common answer was that we did not want any more to touch what was done before. This was not our doing. It was the doing mm-hmm. of our predecessor,
so
former secretary Aguirre.
So systemically, what are you seeing as a problem with the institution?
It is also subject to political considerations, to political influence, that it can be controlled. Mm. Well, the Justice Department mm. is under the president, but it has the power of the president over the Justice Department has limits. The Justice Department has to abide with the rule of law, has to abide with the search, or has to search for the truth. Their mandate is not limited to putting bad men to jail, but also to protect the innocent. That is their mandate. Hindi yung basta-basta na lang magpapakulong kahit alam nilang inosente. And remember, the witness who recanted in my second case na na-acquit ako, sinabi niya sa kanyang judicial affidavit that he did tell the prosecutors, the handling prosecutors, that he would not be expected to testify full proof, to have testimony full proof, mm. because it was a complete lie. And yet, the prosecutors, the panel of prosecutors, still presented him in court. That is so foul, that is unethical, mm. that is prosecutorial misconduct. Mm. The prosecution is not supposed to go through that route. The prosecution is not supposed to do that. That is clearly violative of their mandate. So even with the influence of their superior, the highest superior is the president, the justice secretary being just the alter ego of the president, then they are violating their very solemn oath. Mm.
But then if this can happen to you, this can happen to any ordinary individual.
That's another matter. And that's why my case really was taken seriously by many. That's why my case caught the attention of the international community. And that is why some embassies, some foreign embassies, had sent court observers because of the very significance of my case. If that can be done to me, a public figure at that, and with that track record, imagine GCHR chairperson, mm-hmm. justice secretary, and then a senator, and that was done to me, and what more to others. And that is exactly what I meant when I said that napakasakit na makulong ka na wala kang kasalanan, kaya sinabi ko rin na sana hindi na ito mangyari kahit kanino man. Okay. Ay, marami dyan maliliit na mga nakakulong, mga ordinaryong mga tao nakakulong, mm-mm. na maaring wala rin mga kasalanan.
Mm-mm. Let's go back to that day when you first entered the detention cell. The first one was, you were transferred at one point. Where was the first?
When I was arrested?
Yeah.
I was arrested in the Senate grounds. They wanted to arrest me at my home, but I would not have it. Mm. I cannot afford to my family to see me arrested. So I had to rush. Parang naghabulan pa kami noon. I had to rush back to the Senate. And doon ako nagpa-aresto. And then from there, I was taken to the PNP, to Camp Krame. And then sa CIDG, mm-mm. to do the whole mm-mm. process mm-mm. of fingerprints mm-mm. and all.
Okay, mm-hmm. I want to roll this. This is an old interview, 6.5 years ago, okay. before you were detained. This moment, right before the 2024 days, this is the first day of the 2024 days, most likely. All right, let's hear this.
Ito yung mic ko to. To, mic.
So sasama na po ako sa kanila voluntarily. Nananalig po ako sa mahal na Diyos. Na malalampasan ko rin po lahat na ito. Nagkakaroon ng palagi kong sinasabi ulit po ngayon. Kung inosente po ako, wala pong katotohanan, bawang kasinungalingan, ang mga pinaparata po nila sa akin na ako ay di umano ay nakinabang sa droga, di umano lumagap sa drug money, di umano ay nag-cuddle o nag-protect ng mga drug convicts. Bawat po kasinungalingan, yan, lalabas po ang katotohanan.
When you see that, seeing that now, really, how do you feel?
That memory is still very fresh in me, and it's high emotion. I feel so emotional now, really. Mm. Because that's it, that's the truth, that I'm innocent. And what's happening now, the developments about the recanting witnesses, so it's there. It makes me emotional, really. Talagang fresh na fresh pa yon, and I was almost crying. I remember I was almost crying when I was facing that throng of media that time that I was going down. I was not yet arrested at that point. I was going down the basement mm-hmm. of the Senate because I was told that the arresting team was there already. So hinarang ako ng mga media at yan ang mga sinabi ko. Fresh, nandyan pa rin yan. Hindi ko yan makakalimutan.
But 6 years ago when you see this, do you say to yourself, no one listened to me. They didn't believe me.
Yeah, most did not believe me. Because of the extent, the gravity, the magnitude of the vilification that was done to me, many believed it. And you know the reason why many did believe it? Because of the strategy that was adopted by Duterte and his subalterns, that, you know, in order for more people to believe, because if it is only purely the accusations of my being, of my drug links, I don't think many people would believe that because of my track record. But they had to infuse the sexuality angle, the immorality angle, for more people to believe that. Kasi alam mo na, sa pagsabihin na immoral ang isang babae, babae pa at that, iisipin ng mga tao, kaya pala. You know, yung mga ganyan, yung mga...
Kasi kaya gagawin niya yun.
Gagawin niya yun.
Oo, tatanggap siya.
Kailangan niya ng mga maraming pera, and all that. And that's what and it was a brilliant strategy on the part. I have to concede to that. Kaya maraming naniwala, and it was so painful that, you know, some friends of mine would tell me, even some office mates of them, who are educated, would believe. So it was doubly painful for me. It was painful that I was being wrongly, falsely accused, and the accusation was really pervasive. It was toxic, you know, the toxic language of the president, almost daily cursing. And then you have this realization that many were made to believe that. So it's doubly painful for me.
Okay, now I'm sorry to ask you this. I mean, your personal life is your personal life, but I want to ask you on that front, why did you think, did he betray you? Why did he do it? And have you spoken? Have you forgiven him?
Well, I have spoken all of them except for one, my chief oppressor. I think you know that
I've
already.
Said that. Yeah,
yeah. Well, he's vulnerable. He's vulnerable. Maybe he thought that, because at that point when I was arrested, I had no communication anymore to him or with him. I had no communication. So maybe he thought that I abandoned him, although there was no relationship already. Even if I was already at the DOJ, DOJ, there was no such relationship already. So maybe he felt abandoned, or maybe he felt that he just had to do it. And also because of the pressure on him. He did say that in his affidavit, that there was pressure on him, that he was also coerced to falsely testify against me.
Mm-mm. Now, 7 witnesses who want to recant, or who have, this is in relation to the second dismissed drug case, they're now requesting, I'm just reading this just to update you on the news, they're now requesting a transfer to the National Bilibid Prisons for safety. They're now in Sablayan Prison in Occidental Mindoro, and they fear for their life. So these are 7 witnesses who want to recant, and you have already, I believe, a few major personalities who've also recanted. This is related to the first 2 drug cases. All right. So that's just an overview of the case situation. When you got in, did you think you would stay there for almost 7 years? I mean, seriously.
Honestly, no.
Exactly.
I thought it would just be a few days, actually.
You know that feeling of paparusahan lang ako nito. Alam mo yung ganun?
Yeah.
Paano ko nito patitikman?
Yeah, it was just momentarily. Oh. Yeah, because we filed a petition in the Supreme Court, and I thought I'm gonna get a favorable decision. But it was a close vote, actually. 9-6. 9 in favor of dismissal of my petition, questioning my arrest, and 6 dissented. It was a close vote. I could have been released already at that point, a few months after the arrest. So I thought it's just going to be, in fact, before I went down on the day of my arrest, I summoned my staff. I convened them and I told them, relax lang kayo, sandali lang siguro ito. You know, a few days, few months, a few weeks, a few months.
Months pa nga, it happens. Oo. Yeah. Kasi then, you're not convicted.
Yeah, sabi ko baka matagal na yung 1 year. Ganun pa yung sabi ko. And then, as you saw it, tumagal nang tumagal.
Life in jail, life in detention. I know you've been asked about this. I asked you also over the phone. But you know why people ask you about this? They imagine themselves, could I have lasted? That's the first thing I asked. If it happened to me, could I have lasted? I'm sure Maria asked the same thing. Could I have lasted, right? It's always what you ask. Kaya ko ba yun? What would I do if I were in her shoes? So what was it like? Number one, okay, how did you eat?
Well, I didn't accept the food, the regular food from the custodial authorities on advice of my friends for safety reasons.
Yun lang yun.
So from, yes, uh-oh, from day one. Yes, kasi hindi naman ako choosy when it comes to food. I eat anything edible, actually. So for safety reasons, I had to decline the food, the regular food being supplied by custodial authorities. So my food come from my household and also from my relatives and and some friends.
Every day nagpapadala.
Every day. Okay. Every morning.
Number two, this is might be striking. You have maximum, in maximum prison, convicted prisoners who have cell phones. In the National Bilibid, did Leila de Lima have a cell phone?
Not at all. Not from day one.
No.
The whole
time.
Yes. In fact, nung sa hostage taking, yung hostage taker was asking for my phone, for my cell phone. Sabi niya, ma'am, nasaan yung cell phone mo? Kasi kailangan kong, meron akong papatawagan. Yung mga kasamahan daw niya sa sulong, his Abu Sayyaf. And sabi ko, wala akong cell phone. And then he said, imposible. Wala talaga akong cellphone. Never akong nagka-cellphone. Papatayin kita, ma'am, kung hindi mo, kahit maghapon kang maghanap dyan, wala kang makikita. That's true. My staff would attest to that. I strictly abide by that regulation.
Why didn't you smuggle in a cellphone? I mean, I won't say anything who, but you know, so many VIPs have cellphones in detention.
I cannot take it in my conscience to violate rules like that. These are rules.
So you can't even violate a cell phone rule, what more a drug rule?
Exactly.
I think that's the whole point.
No, all contrabands, you know, nothing. No contrabands in my detention area. That's why I had no TV, because that's a contraband.
You're kidding.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I had no ref. That's also not allowed.
But in NBP, in the Bilibid, there's a ref, there's a stove, there's a cell phone, there's internet.
Yeah, I have no stove. I requested for it because I wanted sana to cook for myself because I'm a good cook.
Uh-oh.
So that's why I had no choice but to just have delivery of food for my household. I wanted to cook na lang sana.
Uh-oh. They declined the
stove. For convenience. Diba? But they declined the stove because that's also not allowed. That's among the listed contrabands. So all the contrabands...
So 7 years, no phone, no TV, no internet.
I didn't even have shower.
No.
Yes. Tabot lang.
But you were not convicted, huh? I mean, wait. Usually.
Those are the rules. Rules are rules in the PNP Custodial Center.
So people detained in the custodial center don't have a shower. May tabot, pwede ka maligo.
Yes, of course.
Oh, you naman.
And I have a small, a CR.
What about visitors?
Visitors are allowed on certain days, Tuesday to Friday and Saturday. And Tuesday to Friday is 1 to 5, Saturday and Sunday, 8 to 5. But during the pandemic, the first few months, total lockdown. Not even family, not even lawyers, not even spiritual advisors. So there are visiting hours and subjected to certain rules.
Okay.
Now, court order is also required for visitors outside of family, outside of lawyers, spiritual advisors, and doctors.
My gosh. All right. Now, COVID. I mean, ordinary people that were in their homes already felt lonely. Many have mental issues. I mean, suicide rates during COVID globally were quite high. Here you were in detention with no TV. At least people were watching television or, you know, they were streaming or watching YouTube. But what were you doing in your cell during COVID?
That's why I had to develop a strict daily routine in my life.
What was the routine?
Oh, I wake up.
What
between
time?
4:30 to 5.
Okay.
Then I start praying.
All right.
and reading the Bible, praying the rosary, reading the Bible, reflections, writing my reflections in my journal.
So you had ballpen and a notebook?
Yes.
They allowed?
And it's all handwritten. Oh. Everything is handwritten. My instructions from my staff and my letters to family.
Yeah.
Yeah. That,
it should be a book.
Example yan.
It should
and
be
yung
in
mga,
a book.
Yung mga dispatches ko from Krame, my commentaries on burning issues of the day.
But where? Would how would you down. Read them? How would you know the burning issues?
I have newspapers every day.
They allowed?
Yes, they allowed. At least that's allowed. And also my staff would bring in twice a day what they call media or comms pouch, where they collate notable online articles, which I read. So I'm very much updated. So on issues that I would want to comment on, I would write in dispatches like that. Everything are handwritten. So inaabot ko sa guard, tapos yung guard, ilalabas niya doon sa gate, iaabot sa staff ko for uploading and mm-hmm. for encoding. Mm-hmm. So there's a mobile office outside in a vehicle. Nandun yung computer, nandun yung laptop, nandun yung printer ng staff ko.
Okay. Now, one of the most unjust, I mean, other than the fact that it's just unjust as a whole, is you were a sitting senator and they didn't even allow you to do your work. And yes. I always say this because former Senator Antonio Trillanes, I interviewed him in detention.
Allowed.
He had, his staff would go at least and visit him, report to him. He would be able to function. I think he even had hearings at one point in a detention cell. You were not at all.
Yes, I tried asking that from my colleagues that they refused. Yeah. They declined.
Hindi pa sumamaloob mo nun.
Siyempre sumamaloob ko. I was really, I felt sorry about that. I felt bad about that because I wanted really to participate. Kahit hindi na nila ako paboto, it's okay na I was not allowed to vote. At least allow me to participate in deliberations, at least on major legislative measures. Participate in deliberations, in the debate, and also in the committee hearings on important legislative measures so that I could contribute my thoughts and insights thereon. Mm-hmm. And remember that during the pandemic, they actually amended the rules to allow video conferencing. Mm-hmm. So some of the members, some of the senators participated through online, via online. So if they can do that, why not me? But, you know, the only thing that I was deprived of is my physical liberty. Mm-mm. Because I was not yet convicted.
Who was Senate President then when you were detained? Maybe the first few years?
The first few years was Coco Pimentel and then Senator Soto.
Oh.
When I applied for that, to be able to participate, it was already Senator Soto. And my lawyers filed an appropriate motion in court. It was also denied. Mm-hmm. It could have been granted if only my colleagues supported it. Mm-hmm.
And you still have faith? I mean, think of it. You know, it's a treatment that's so different for another person and to you. I mean, seriously speaking, there was a precedent at that point. You had Antonio Trillanes, right, who was opposition all the way and yet was allowed to function. I mean, what did you realize? I mean, do you really still respect or look up to your colleagues the way that people should? Did you get bitter, upset, angry?
I was definitely hurt, but I always think that they have reasons, their own reasons, politically and even personally, I think.
Kumbaga, although, inintindi mo.
Inintindi ko. Pinilit ko na lang na intindihin rather than, you know, have some ill will towards them.
Okay, the ill will, all right. Was there any point, frankly, that you lost hope? I mean, 1 year, okay, fine. 2 years, I don't know, hitting three, you're detained. You had former President Duterte, extremely popular. Then you're thinking, you know, was there a point that you said, look, let me just, I don't know, cut a deal?
Believe it or not, never. I never lost hope.
Really?
It's the only thing that I would cling to. Hope.
Why?
Losing hope would mean is the end of it. Is the end of my life if I would lose hope. That's the only thing. Because if we lose hope, then everything would fall apart. You know, your health would suffer, and then you have nothing to really look forward to.
Ang tibay mo din.
Oh, you know, so.
But when President Marcos Jr. won, yung totoo, were you scared? Did you say, baka magtagal pa ako dito, baka dito pa ako i-convict?
I was actually hoping that there would be really change, that there would be openness on you know, on the positive developments in my case, that there would be openness in terms of respecting the judicial system and the judiciary. But I was actually, to be honest about it, I was expecting it early on. Because as I said, I was expecting the new Justice Secretary to order an exhaustive review of my case to the end of possibly withdrawing the case rather than wasting the time and resources of the state, especially of the courts.
Okay, now, okay, I heard that. That's something there. All right, very quickly. What I found interesting, before we go to a commercial gap, these nuances in court, while in detention, I find interesting because it talks about strength of character, right? It talks about self-reflection, surviving, thriving in very difficult environments. It's you were talking to the cats.
Yeah.
Really, seriously. I mean, you know, you'd have to find a friend at one point somewhere there, right? So those cats, how many cats did you have?
More than 20.
Yeah.
Although some of them had passed away already, either for health reasons and na tumanda na rin yung iba, old age. I had more than 20. They really meant a lot. They made the difference also, you know, almost at the break, the point of feeling depressed. But I never reached that point because of them. They were my companions, loyal companions, loving companions. As you said, I talked to them,
absolutely,
especially during the pandemic.
Yeah.
Yung total.
I talked to my dogs.
Total lockdown.
Yeah.
I have dogs at home.
Yeah.
I used to hate cats. Now I love them. I got so attached to them, and they have different characters actually. So I feed them twice a day. So I really love them so much, and in fact, I felt so bad when I could not bring them all home. I wanted to bring them all home, but it was not possible for me because I had no space at home. So I could only bring 5 of them. So they're so important.
Okay.
They played a very important role in my life in terms of surviving it all.
Now, before we go to a quick break so we can talk about the ICC, is you told me that one of the most painful moments while you were detained was you weren't even allowed to pay your respects or to mourn the death of former president, the late President Noynoy Aquino, right? Just to get out, go to the wake, and go back in.
Yeah.
Okay, talk about that. And was there any other, like the darkest moment you had in detention?
Well, the other happening was when my son graduated from law school. I wanted to attend his graduation personally. We applied with court for permission, but the court denied it. Also, when my only sister-in-law passed away, I wanted to also pay my respects. So it was painful also. I cried, and as you said, former President Aquino and former Secretary Dinky Suleiman.
Yeah.
I wanted to pay my last respects also, personally. But I didn't apply anymore when they denied my request to visit the wake of my sister-in-law. So I just cried. I just cried in the privacy of my detention cell.
Yeah. Did you feel an ounce of compassion or humanity from the former administration? I mean, you hear stories of VIPs getting in and out of detention.
Well, that makes it more revolting, actually. But I didn't want to be insisting on that, because I would also think about the ordinary detainees who would not have that opportunity. Mm. You know, they didn't have any access to the powers that be, that they could be granted the same privileges. Mm-mm. So kapag dinideny kung ano man yung rini-request ko, that's it. Mm. I don't push for it. Wow. I really don't insist on it.
You never lobbied.
I didn't lobby. Because I also didn't want that people would have the impression that I was having special treatment. You know, so I was also very careful about it. Mm-mm. But I know that I have certain rights, and there must be some space for that, given my stature also. Mm-hmm.
And the fact you weren't convicted.
And that I was not convicted.
Your priority now is, number one, you've called for accountability, but you also want to participate with the International Criminal Court, right?
Yeah, just to assist.
To assist.
In whatever way I can.
Exactly.
If needed.
If needed. Yes. What kind of assistance do you see yourself offering?
As you know, I headed the investigation into the Davao Death Squad killings. Although it's the coverage of that investigation is not really part of the duration of the ICC investigation, because the ICC investigation is from 2011 to 2019. 2011, when we acceded to the Rome Statute, and 2019, when the withdrawal, the unilateral withdrawal, took effect. Mm. Now, the investigation by the CHR was in 2019. But you see, the results of that investigation would serve as very useful reference for the ICC investigation on the drug war killings under the Duterte administration, because it sort of laid down the factual premises of the death squads. Mm-mm.
How extensive was your Davao Death Squad investigation?
It was extensive enough. Although the findings that we adopted, the resolution that I prepared, were not actually officially adopted, because when I left, it was not completed yet. Mm. But I completed it when I was the Secretary of Justice, and I presented it. I turned it over to the CHR, but it was not wholly adopted by the CHR then. Mm-mm. So it is a reference point, to because it is where, you know, the names of Edgar Matobato, Arturo Las Cañas first came out. And then years later, in 2016,
there was a Senate hearing.
Yes, it was officially confirmed their very existence, and then their stories were heard during that Senate investigation, which again I headed, but I was ultimately ousted as the chairperson. Mm-hmm. It also gave us insights on how these were organized, the Davao Death Squads, and then the use of intelligence funds to fund the operations, the killings, the reward system, the organization, the use of police officers.
So you're studying that the investigation that the confidential funds of Davao were used to fund the Davao Death Squad?
Yes. That's part of the testimony, is the revelations of Edgar Matobato and Arturo Las Cañas and some other resource persons that we talked to during the CHR investigation. Mm. So there's a pool of important information that we got that can be used as reference points, because the drug war killings were just a replication of those DDS killings that we investigated in 2009. Mm. So it would be very useful to take a look at that and made it as reference comparison to the findings now that the ICC that the ICC investigation team had gathered.
Okay, ang tanong ng iba yan, it's 2024 days, almost 7 years. Mm-hmm. Hindi ka pa ba pagod? Other people would ride off, frankly, into the sunset, have a quiet life. You know what I mean? They'll say, okay, I'm staying off politics. I'm gonna change careers. I'm gonna plant vegetables or something, right? But not you. I mean, the minute you got out, you said it's a time of reckoning. You're not coming out with bitterness. You have forgiveness, but it's a time of reckoning and accountability. Other people won't go that route. Mm-hmm.
After all what was done to me, why should I quit? I didn't quit in the entire almost 7 years of detention. And why should I quit now? Then I would have the opportunity now, and I would have the time to attain my, to achieve full vindication. And why would I quit now that I see the right environment to pursue what I've been pursuing? You know, the developments that we are seeing, that, you know, there's a possibility that the government, the current government, would reverse its original position on the ICC, that who knows, the final position would be to rejoin the ICC, that the position would be to, because if we rejoin, then automatically we need to cooperate. Okay. Even if we do not rejoin ICC, we still have the duty to cooperate, notwithstanding our withdrawal.
Okay, if President Marcos Jr. is watching now and he would see this, what benefit is it to him, frankly, and his administration to rejoin the ICC? You'd have advisors of the president saying, the U.S. isn't even a part of the ICC, Mr. President. Why would you go to the ICC? It'll divide you politically. So I'm acting, right? If I were advising the president, why would you? Why should he?
It is the right thing to do for justice and accountability. It is the right thing to do in order to earn more positive points from the international community, not necessarily the U.S., but the likes of the European Union. You know, because joining the Rome Statute would give us the opportunity now to also join the community of nations that would fight impunity, that would fight tyrants, you know, in states where there would be aberrations of their domestic justice system. There would be aberrations of their political systems, that tyrants would rise. One man rule would be there. And then that's exactly what happened in 2016 to 2022. The aberrations that was the Duterte despotic rule, which result in the carnage, the almost daily carnage, that no one has thought of putting him to accountability. So it is the right thing to do. And not to rejoin would be wholly inconsistent with our track record in affirming human rights principles. We are parties to key international human rights instruments, human rights treaties. And we've been among those who have been active in the formative stage of the Rome Statute and ICC. So why not rejoin the community of nations who would combat tyrants and who would combat impunity?
Okay. Senator Bato de la Rosa has said you need Senate concurrence. Well, right now, that would be 18 votes to go back into the ICC. Would you agree?
I agree with the position of former Senate President Drilon that an executive action would suffice. Because in the first place, the withdrawal was unilateral. The withdrawal, yes, was completed, according to the Supreme Court, in the Pangilinan et al. Versus Cayetano et al. But there was never any ruling as to the validity and constitutionality of that withdrawal.
It would have been
different,
really,
if the Supreme Court categorically ruled that the withdrawal was proper, that it was consistent with the Constitution, that there was nothing wrong with the withdrawal. Because the petition was mooted. It was moot because at the time that the petitions were filed, according to that decision, the withdrawal was completed already. It was complete. So the Supreme Court did not any more categorically rule on the validity or the constitutionality of the withdrawal, but it did lay down very exhaustively very significant principles on the matter of withdrawal. Mm.
So clearly you feel right now it's just an executive decision.
Yes.
That's it.
Yes.
No need for the long process of rejoining again.
Yes.
That's simple.
Yes.
Yeah.
And the president being the chief architect of foreign policy. And so I would hope that his legal advisors would thoroughly study the matter, the Rome Statute itself, the various relevant provisions there, and also the Pangilinan et al. Versus Cayetano et al. Ruling. Because the withdrawal, in fact, yes, the president has some leeway in withdrawing, but there must be definite showing of repugnance to the Constitution, that the adherence to the Rome Statute was violative of the Constitution. Mm. It should have been shown. It should have been manifested in the very act of withdrawal.
Okay, so we don't have enough time to close. I mean, you've already said that you're not running for the Senate.
Yes.
In 2025, am I correct?
I'm not yet thinking about it.
Yeah, so 2025, let's put it there, that's off the table.
Yes.
No, that's gone. So what are your plans? I mean, I want to go short term. Christmas is coming up. This will be your first Christmas at home with your mother, your family, after 7 years.
Yes, it's going to be the best Christmas ever. Well, my immediate plan is to set the process of my going back to private law practice. That's okay. Why next week I'll be starting with my MCLE.
Okay.
Because
I'm not a lawyer. Can you explain that,
please? The mandatory continuing legal education. You have to gain certain units.
So you'll study again?
Yes, some units.
Oh.
Because, well, I used to be exempt when I was DOJ secretary and as a senator, but now no longer. So I enrolled at the UP for the MCLE program.
I
was told that I had to obtain a total of 36 units. So that would be several law subjects.
Two SEMs?
Not really one SEM, but it's a staggered duration of various law subjects.
It's amazing.
Before I can really formally practice.
Yeah.
And then I'm thinking of resuming also my teaching. I had an offer from the DLSU Law, College of Law, and I accepted it. Mm. I'm going to teach starting on January 22 at the College of Law of DLSU.
Okay. What about talks abroad? I mean, I can imagine these, I mean, human rights forums, really. Mm-hmm. Governance, politics. You have Maria Ressa heading the Global Policy Institute in Colombia, I think next year.
Mm-hmm. I've received several invitations already for official, for foreign engagements, but I'd rather that I first focus on the last remaining case, that I'd rather that my remaining case would be over before I accept those invitations.
All right.
Various engagements
so
abroad.
Last words, Leila de Lima today.
Well, I remain to be the same Leila de Lima that you used to know. Unbroken, fearless, and I continue to be so.
On that note, I want to thank you so much, former Senator Leila de Lima, for being here on Head Start Live. You've seen the changes. You were once here, I mean, before and now. You've just seen just how life has changed. It completely.